we want to find the slope between these two points, and we want to figure out, does it rise, fall, horizontal, vertical? Let's see, negative 6, -5. There's a point, -6, -5. Those two points. You don't have to graph them, but as we're starting, that might be helpful. Then we have this carrot, your y2 minus y1, your x2 minus x1. Call this point 2, this point 1, or vice versa, it doesn't matter. It won't make any difference, as long as we do it in the right order here. So 5 minus -5 over -6 minus -6. So we get 10, right? 5 plus 5, that's what that is. Over -6 plus 6 is 0. Okay, so something is a little funny about this slope, right? As a number, like, what is this equal to? What is 10 over 0 equal to?
Zero.
No.
10.
No?
1.
Yes. It's not equal to anything. There is nothing out there that 10 over 0 is equal to. It can be simplified to, or like, you can't find 10 over 0 on a number line. It is undefined. There's no definition. Go to the math dictionary, you look up divided by zero, and there's just blank space because there's no definition for that, okay? But when we talk about what that means as a slope, that can tell us what kind of line that is. It can tell us that it's a vertical line, right? If we look at the two points, there's a line that goes through those two points. It's perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with that line going through those two points like that. But if we say start here and go up to this point and try to figure out what the slope is just by, you know, stepping it off, we go up 10, it'd be rise of 10. But what's the run? 0, right? So we get the run is 0, the denominator is 0, the horizontal is 0. If we're not moving anywhere horizontally, there is no horizontal aspect to this line, then it must all be vertical, because there's no horizontal, right? It's just all vertical. So this is our slope, it's an undefined slope. But an undefined slope always means a vertical line. Yes?
If the slope is zero, then it's horizontal.
That's right. Because it's the reverse then, because then we can go, like, there's no rise at all. It's like a hypothetical here. Graph this line. And if we choose 2 points, when we find the rise over the run, we're going to get no rise at all, and then whatever run you want, it doesn't matter. It's zero rise, and then whatever run, and you still get a zero slope. Next was 16. Let's find the mistake. Let's just kind of point at this and see if we can figure out what the mistake was. Okay, so we got 2 points, let's say point 1 and point 2. So we're going to do y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. Ready? Call this y2. Well, they got a 5. There. Maybe they did the points reversed or something. Y2. No. No matter how we look at it, if we call this y2 or this y2, it doesn't matter. Like, they've already made a mistake, right? Where does 5 come from?
They're going to even find a
5. X. So what they're going to wind up with is x2 minus x1 over y2 minus y1. That's just the reciprocal of what we actually want. Reciprocal of the slope. So we should just flip it over. We should get 1 over -2, or -1/2. Okay? Next. 22. So we have two lines. We want to find both of their, well, we want to find if they're parallel, perpendicular, or neither, right? And the only way to know that for sure, 100% sure, mathematically, is to know both of their slopes, right? Can't look at a picture and guess. It's not good enough. We need to know 100% mathematically that is one or the other. So if they are parallel, what kind of slopes do we have? The same slopes. Both lines will have the same slopes. That makes sense. If they're parallel, and they need to go up and over, rise over, run exactly the same way as each other. So they need to have the same slope. Not as obvious. How do we know the two lines are perpendicular by their slopes?
Opposite
reciprocals, yes. So if this is just hypothetically 2 over 5, then this is negative 5 over 2. So we need to find their slopes to know. And how do we know that they're not parallel or perpendicular? They're not one of those. They're not equal and they're not opposite reciprocals. So we have looked at finding slopes a couple times here today. So jump right into it. 0 minus 2 over 5 minus negative 3. Negative 2 over 8. Negative 1 fourth. All right, so if it's parallel, the other slope should come out negative 1 fourth. If it's perpendicular, the other slope should come out what?
4.
4, positive 4. And if it's neither, it won't be either one of those. We got negative 3 minus negative 4 over 3 minus negative 1. Negative 3 plus 4, that's 1. And 3 plus 1 is 4. That's almost there. A little confusing. Right? It's kind of one of sum of one and sum of the other. Like, if they're both 1 fourth, one of them is negative. So that's not parallel because they're not the same slope. But one's positive, one's negative. So that's like perpendicular lines having opposite, but they're supposed to be reciprocal slopes. So it's got like elements of both, but it doesn't have fully either one, so it's not parallel or perpendicular. All right. When I get done and everybody looks like they've been nodding along and everything, I'm gonna assume we're all good. If we're ever not good, just stop me before I, or after or something. Just make sure that if you still have a question at this point, that you ask it. Page. If you need me to ever go back, just let me know. And so we are on 41,
mm-hmm.
And the last one from this section. Spheres. Escalator in an airport rises 28 feet. So we all know what an escalator looks like. It's got steps. So it rises 28 feet. Horizontal distance of 48 feet. So from there to there, horizontally, it's 48. So how do we figure the slope of this escalator? Rhymes over run, 28 over 48. Simplify it. We got 4, 7 over 12. 7 over 12. They're both divisible by 4. Okay, we good? Define slopes, parallelness, perpendicularness. Find the x and y intercepts. Right. So the instructions say find the x and y intercepts. What does that even mean? What's a y intercept?
Crosses intersects.
Crosses intersects what?
Units.
What is it? What's it intersecting? Intercepting.
The y or x axis.
Okay, the y or x axis. So, I was asking about the y intercept. So it must intercept the y axis. And if we were talking about the x axis, we're talking about the x intercept, right? So, if we want to figure out where, say, on, let's say, the y axis, where on the y axis does the line cross? Okay, well, let's look at points on the y-axis. I'm not saying any of these points is the y-intercept, but any of these points on the y-axis And there's one, only one thing that all of these points have in common. They're on the y-axis, okay? Which means
x is zero.
All their x's are zero. Their x's are zero. Exactly. So if we want to figure out where is that point, where does it cross the y-axis, then we just need to make x zero, and then we'll find out what y is when x is zero. Right? That's how these graphs work.
Yeah.
So we put zero in there, 5y equals negative 15, so y equals negative 3. So we have just found a point where this graph crosses the y-axis, which is zero. And the opposite is true of a point that crosses the x-axis, or a point that's on the x-axis. That must be where y is equal to 0. So we'll plug in y is 0, and we'll get x equals negative 15. Easy. There's our point right there. Okay. We know that any function that looks like this is going to be a linear function. Going to be a line when we graph it. So we graph it, we know it's a line, so we can just connect these two points to the straightish line. What have I really done when I've drawn that line? What have I really done?
Given it a slope.
Okay, give it a slope. Kind of already had the slope before I did anything. Yeah, so how many of input outputs have I just drawn?
Well, actually
a lot. A lot. How many when I draw the line itself?
All of them.
An infinite number. And yeah, all of them like in this window, because there's even more past this, right? That's why we put an arrow. It just keeps on going. There's an infinite number between here and here. There's also just an infinite number everywhere. Between any two points, there's an infinite number of inputs and outputs to be defined. When we start graphing graphs, it becomes a game of finding key points. And in graphing lines, specifically, it becomes a game of just finding two points, because that's all we need, two points, and we graph it, okay? If we get x by itself, which helps a little bit, x equals 3. Okay. So, Let's start with this right here. Can you show me somewhere on the graph where x is equal to 3? Just a place where x is equal to 3.
Over 3.
Over 3. So you're motioning to the right, right? 3, of course. Of course, that's where x is equal to 3. Where else is x equal to 3? How about here? Here? No. Over here?
No.
Here? What about here?
No.
Yeah.
Is x equal to 3 there?
Yeah.
It's 3 comma, I don't know. I didn't really mark that y-axis, but it is 3 comma something. And it doesn't really matter what the something is, right? You could look at it like this. Let's say 0y plus x equals 3. Is that true? Is it equal to what is right above it? Yeah. Because no matter what I put in there for y, what happens? You multiply by 0, and it becomes 0. And that doesn't really do anything to the equation, but it does help us see that no matter what I plug in for y, I can plug anything I want, 50, negative 2, 3/5, it doesn't matter. It's going to get multiplied by 0, and x will just always be 3, whatever the y is. And anywhere on this vertical line, we'll have x is equal to 3. 5. Walk. Part of the way 6 miles an hour, part of the way 3.5 miles per hour. Bob, for the situation is this guy. If R is the number of hours that I run and W is the number of hours that I walk, 6 miles an hour times the number of hours plus 3.5 miles an hour times the number of hours, that should give me a number of miles, just number of miles, and that should all add up to 14. That's the total that I'm going to walk. A pretty simple equation to put together. Graph the equation. Okay, let's graph the equation. We said it's just a game of finding the easiest 2 points to graph. Okay. What will be an easy point to find? 0 for what? 0 for R. So we plug in 0 for R. 6 times 0 plus 3.5 times W equals 14. That's gone. Divide by 3.5. W equals 14 divided by 4. 4. W is 4. Okay. Well, we're going to graph it. We're going to kind of decide which is R and which is W, which axis is R and which axis is W. What's that? X could be R. Why not? And Y is W. Okay. So. What R was 0, so R is 0, and W is 4. That would be the slowest way to do this, right? It would take the most amount of time. Agree?
Yeah.
It would take 4 hours to walk it. That would be the slowest way that you could travel. What would be another point that would be easy to find?
0 for W.
6R plus 3.5 times 0 equals 14. Equals 14. 6R equals 14. R equals 14 over 6 equals 7 over 3. For 7 thirds of an hour, that's 3 thirds, 6 thirds, 7 thirds, right? If we think about it just for a second, I didn't really ask us to think about it, but we'll go ahead and think about it. Does this part of the graph make much sense? Over here. What doesn't make sense about this?
Negative.
Yeah, negative running time. We don't have any negative running time, right? It was, unless we run backwards or something? I don't know what that negative running time means. The time is still moving forward. I don't know. Maybe you're running backwards before the walk. So I don't know. I
unless
guess
you find some way to run backwards in time.
Yeah, that's gonna be a tough one. So, what about this guy? This down here doesn't make a lot of sense in the context either, right? Because now we're talking about negative walking time. Walking time. So that's not gonna make a lot of sense. So if we're gonna graph this actual scenario, it would make more sense to leave out the negative values for R and W. Anyway, give 3 possible combinations of running and walking times. How are you going to figure that out? You could use the line if you're really good at graphing and you've graphed a really, really great line and you're really good at reading your really good graph. Then absolutely, you go to 1 and then it looks like 3. Might be 3. I'm not sure. Well, to say I'm going to go to 1. I'm not sure if that's 3 or not. How can I know for sure?
Plug
1 in for R. Or anything you want for R or for W, right? So 6 times 1 plus 3.5 times W equals 14. I don't know why I put that in parentheses. Necessary. 3.5 W, we'll subtract 6 from both sides. So we get 8. And what's 8 divided by 3.5?
2.28.
But that is a solution, 1 and 2.28. 1 hour, what, 1 hour running, 2.28 hours walking. And then we need, well, three examples. Well, here's one. I don't walk at all, I only run. And here's another one, I don't run at all, I just walk. So 0.4, and what was that, 7/3 0, and then this is supposed to be 1, 2.28. There's three possibilities. Make sense? Did the teacher all good? You guys understand it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then if there are no more questions, which I think there are not. And let's pass in the homework slash pink sheets and make sure it asks, let's make this. So I'm going to ask a question from the homework just like this. So we'll approach it the same way. We're looking for
perpendicular, parallel,
either the same slope, opposite reciprocal slopes, or not either of those. So I'll do 6 minus negative 1, 2 minus negative 3, that's 6 plus 1, that's 7, that's 2 plus 3, that's 5. Line number 2, finding the slope, 5 minus 0, 3 minus negative 4, that's 5. So, we found the slopes correctly, and now we have to draw a conclusion. What's our conclusion about whether they're parallel, perpendicular, or either?
Neither.
Neither. As, well, what are they almost?
They're almost perpendicular, but they're not opposites.
We need to have them opposite. One needs to be
angled. I totally forgot about the opposite part, and I said they were perpendicular, but now I remember. So
I remember. That sounds like a 4 out of 5. Yeah, one of them needs to be negative. Really, they're not, these lines are not even close to being perpendicular, right? But their slopes kind of look like they're close to being opposite. So they're not either one. Either. Right. So we look at the slope for line one, question one, so that'd be 7/5. So I'm talking about x and y. Which one of these is related to y and which to x? 7 is related to the y value. So y is measured in inches. So this would be 7 inches, right? Because if I did so many, 5 inches minus, no, it wasn't 5. Whatever. Some inches minus some other inches, I have some inches. Yeah. And x is measured in years. What would be the rate of change of y relative to x? What does that mean, the rate of change?
7 inches per year.
And almost.
Is it 5 years?
7 inches per 5 years. That's a rate of change, right? 7 inches per 5 years. That's not usually how we say things, right? We say usually per 1 year, per 1 mile, per 1 second, per one whatever. Well, what is this in inches per year? Can we express that?
You go and put it equal to 1 year on the bottom, and you have to cross multiply by that.
Okay, yeah, sure. That's a 7/5, inches per year, per G, inches per, yeah, equals x inches. Let's call it, because x is already used, and I might get confusing, let's call it m inches per 1 year, okay, cross multiply. So we get 5m equals 7, and solving for m here, right, divide by 5 on both sides, m equals, so it looks like I can just take 7 divided by 5, and that will be blah blah per 1 year, right? 7/5 inches per year. Or 1.4 inches per year. Now, if we're trying to graph a line and we want to use a slope, we want to use this guy, right, or this guy. We probably don't want to use this one right here. But if I want to talk about how fast something's actually moving or happening, changing, then I'll probably want to say 1.4. And it depends on the context. This is not an easy slope to use. This is a much easier slope to use. But this makes more sense if I say that such and such a plant grows at 1.4 inches per year. That's easier to kind of visualize in your head, make a little video of, right? Easier than 7 inches every 5 years. A little bit weird. Good? Questions? Okay. The following equations, label y, intercept for each. That disappeared, but there it is. You can certainly feel free to use the y-intercept and the slope and just graph it that way. But also, every time I tell you how to graph this, I'm going to put it in terms of input and output. I'll never stop doing that until, I don't know, months and months and months in the future when this is just like some tiny part of some other problem we're doing. Okay? Because I want to emphasize that to graph a graph, you need to find some of its points. You don't want to find all of them, because how many are there? An infinite. That's too many. That is not reasonable. Okay? So we're going to find as many as we need. And how many do we need to graph a line?
Two.
At least two. Or more. And if we find more, we'll just keep finding them on this line that we can connect with the two dots. The easiest point to find would be
zero
for x. Plug in zero for x. Plug in zero for x, what are you going to get for y?
Negative 3.
It's so simple. This goes away, and we're left with y equals -3. There we go. Now, what should we do? Should we go over to x is 1?
No.
No, could we?
Yeah.
Sure. But it would be a real hassle, because we'd have to find common denominator and so on. So we're going to go over to x is 6. X is 6. Right? You'll notice, as I talk about this in the next few moments, it'll be exactly like following the slope. Right? We're moving over 6. Why would we move over 6? Okay, so if I'm thinking in terms of slope, that's the run, right? That's 6, that's the run. Right? But also, if I think in terms of input and output, if I move over to 6, what happens when I plug 6 in for x? Here, I multiply by this fraction 5/6. Well, let's see, 5/6 times 6 over 1. What happens when I multiply 5/6 by 6? Yeah, this 6 cancels that 6, right? When we multiply fractions, we get that cross cancellation, and 6 divided by 6 is 1, so we're just left with 5 plus -3, or -3 plus 5, right? So what did I just do? I went over to x is 6, right? That would be like the run, over 6, and what did I do? I added 5 to what? -3. -3, the starting point, the y-intercept. Over 6, and I went up 5, that's up 3, got 2 more. Or I inputted 6, and I got out 2. If I want to find another point, which I don't have to, because I have 2, and that's all I need to find a line, to graph a line. But I'd move over 6 more. 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 more, because that's x equals 12. And when I put in x equals 12, that is also a multiple of 6, and that also will cancel out. Denominator of 6, right? But I won't add on 5, I'll add on 10, right? That's just up another 5. So you can see how plugging in the right, like the just the right x, following the slope, it's the exact same thing. That's what following the slope is. It's just going to the next best x. Going over by 6s, and every time I go over by 6, I'll go up by 5. So go up 5 more, 2, 3, 4, 5. I guess I should connect those. again, it's a game of finding the easiest points. What would be one of the easiest points to find in this case? Put 0 in for x, find y. Plug 0 in for y, find x. Right? That's the simplest way that I could think of. You could put it in slope-intercept form and go from there, but also it'd be a lot easier to just say 7 times 0 plus 3y. It'd be a lot easier if I didn't even write that down. It'd be a lot easier if I realized that's just going to be gone, right? And I could just look at it and see 3y equals 21. If I have a 3, y must be 7. Real, real easy. All right, so 0, 7. Do the same thing, put in 0 for y, that's going to go away, 7x equals 21, I can clearly see x is 3. There we go. And now I just plotted the infinite number of points, by drawing that line. Saving up for a box set. Let's cut to the salient points. It's $180 to buy this thing. You're gonna pay for it with the two jobs that you have. One is $6 an hour, the other is $10 an hour. You'll notice this is a lot like the homework problem about running and walking. Do this at this rate, and I do this other thing at this other rate. I have one job that's $6 an hour, that's a rate, right? Dollars per hour. This is another rate, dollars per hour. So this is the function that represents how long or, you know, how many hours I need to work at each job to get the $180 I'm looking to earn. I could have cut everything out. I could have just said, here's an equation. Give two solutions to this equation. That would have been it. But I get some context to it. Now x and y mean something. So now we're going to figure out two solutions. 0 and for x, what does that mean in the context of the equation? Only working at this job. Okay, if I exclusively work at this job, which would be ideal because that is the most money, that's the shortest amount of time, right? I'm watching walking dead in no time. So we just plug in 0 is 10y equals 180. Y is 18. Alright, so there's one solution. That word solution is a really important word. This, whenever that word comes up, you should pay attention, pay close attention. Okay. This is a solution because when you plug it in, what happens when you plug in 0 and 18?
It works.
The equation is
complete.
Right?
The word is true.
It's true. It's a statement, right? We're saying something, 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 something is something else. When I say that, that's a statement. That's either it's true or it's false. And when we plug in numbers and it's true, we found a solution. Anyway, we continue on, and what do you think? We plug in 0 for the other one, right? So we divide by 6 on both sides, 30 hours. That would be the slowest way to go about it. Work exclusively at a job that doesn't pay you as much, 30 hours.
You have a job that's just 6 hours.
6 hours an hour?
Yeah.
That's all you got. You're just between things right now.
But you have a job that has $10 an hour.
Oh, it's not up to you, you know. This is just... I don't need an angry mob in here. Just make it a comment. Alright, any questions from the review at all? Anything that I passed? Okay, we're good. You can go ahead and score it. 25. Pass it back to its owner. So, like I said last time, we've been talking about functions real generally in our prerequisite review. Of the things that we should be familiar with from before this class. And now that we've talked about them in general, graphs in general, functions in general, we're going to talk about linear functions. Okay? So we did some graphing of linear functions using the intercepts, using the slope and the y-intercept, and just talking about what it takes to graph a line. So now we're going to be talking about solving linear equations. Easiest equations we could possibly be tasked to solve. Okay? And I'm sure you have solved them before. Okay? And I'm going to get on my soapbox here for a little bit to warn you about something. Okay? You may have been developing a very incredibly bad habit, a that I want you to break today, okay?
Oh boy.
It's a good time to break it. If you are doing this, if this is a habit of yours, you need to break it today. So, here it is, something like x minus 2 equals 14. A very bad habit would be if I asked you, you know, what is x, and you say 16. And then I say, well, can you show me your work? And you say, well, I don't know how to show my work. I can just see it.
What?
Okay?
That doesn't mean know.
You need to get in the habit of showing your work. Not because I love seeing work so much. It's not for me. It's for you. If you don't know how to show the work of figuring out what x is, it's going to make future more and more difficult equations, more and more difficult to solve, and impossible to just see. Just guess. Okay? We'll put up an equation. Now, this is an extreme example. It's from way down the road. But here's an example. I don't care how good at just seeing it you are, or at guessing and checking you are, you'll never guess what the solution exactly for this is. Unless you have some kind of background in solving quadratics and you know that they're going to look like this, they could look like this, and you are just fine-tuning it. I mean, by the time you guess the right answer, somebody else could have solved it much, much faster, okay? But this seems like a complete mystery as to how to solve this if we don't start with this right now, today, right? And do what to solve this equation? How would you solve this equation painstakingly, showing all of your work?
Take x plus 2.
Plug in x.
No. we're gonna see, that's the thing. We can see it, I can just see, what is x? No, 14, no, 2, 15, no, 16. I got it, right? That's not gonna be yes anymore. Yeah?
Add two.
Okay, we'll talk a little bit more about why and how we know to do the right thing and all that kind of stuff more in a minute. But if you can't grasp that, or you resist doing that, even later today, there's going to be equations that are too difficult for guessing, or so tedious that you just don't want to guess, right? Like the correct answer is 11 halves, or is 5 over 11. Like, who's going to guess 5 over 11? Maybe eventually you would, but I mean, does anybody think they can guess the correct answer to this equation?
You actually got me working.
And I mean exactly right. I don't mean pretty close. I don't mean you get 0.00000001 when you plug in your x. I mean you get exactly zero. And not calculator zero. Not your number is so close that your calculator gives up and says zero. I mean actually zero. Okay? If you think that you have, if you just had enough time, plug in just the right number to give you the solutions right here.
What?
Okay, there's two solutions. This one, and there's this one. You were just about to guess this one, right? You were about to...
Yeah, it's...
Oh, yeah, totally. In my brain.
Yeah. So, now, if you know about the quadratic formula, this is not very hard to find, but also, even better than the quadratic formula is, you should be able to complete the square, which is how we find the quadratic formula, all that kind of stuff. But we can't even begin to understand all that stuff with fluency until we can feel comfortable showing our work. Now, I don't expect to see your work every time there is this, like, one little step to take. That's not what I'm saying. If you can't show your work, you don't know how you did it, you can just see it. Okay? If you're a just seer or a guesser and a checker, you got to stop today. Alright? And I know that stuff is in there somewhere, floating around. Let's try and just scoop it all up, put it together, and start using it. Okay? Think algebraically, not guess and check. Okay? That's old stuff. We don't want to use that old stuff. So let's start with things that are simple, and also understanding what an equation is, all right? Let's talk about this guy right here. X minus 2 is equal to 14. Something really simple. Actually, we'll start with a different equation, because 14 is kind of big when I'm trying to use a manipulative like this.
Okay.
So, here we go. This is an equation, okay? Why is this an equation? It's completely equal, right? Is this an equation?
Yeah.
No. This an equation?
Yeah.
This an equation?
No.
No. Equation implies equal. One side is equal, it's completely balanced, right? So, you know, if, let's say that I change this a little bit. Is this an equation?
Yes.
Yeah, it's still an equation. Right. If you can't see it probably, but there's four of these little guys right here. And there's two of them over here, and then this mystery box here. Okay? So our job is in algebra is to figure out what's in
mystery box.
Mystery box. What is in the mystery box? Or what is the mystery box worth? Which is just as simple as get the mystery box by itself on one side, and then all the other like white things over here, so that we know how many it's worth. Simple, right?
How many are in the
system? There's four here, two there. So I want to get mystery box by itself. You can't see it, but there's two white discs over here. But I don't care about these two white discs. I just want an x. So how do I get the x to be by itself? Take these away. Let's see what happens when I subtract two from one side. So I need to take two off of this side, right? Take equal parts from both sides. Okay? Simple as that. Now, I'm not going to make you sit there while I display how we subtract both sides, add both sides, divide both sides by the same thing, multiply both sides by the same thing. But the idea is the same. If I were to divide this side by 2, we need to divide this side by 2. Or to multiply this by 5/7, we need to multiply this by 5/7. And then it becomes harder to do with the manipulative, right? Multiply by 5/7, then we need to, that's why we represent them with symbols and numbers and equations rather than this, right? It would be much easier if you were, say, a merchant in ancient who knows where, right? And you have these scales that you're trying to reconcile, figure out how much somebody owes you or how much you owe somebody else, right? It's much easier to say, well, I got these pieces, I'm just gonna write this stuff down on paper and work it out that way, right? And work it out symbolically the way you would actually work it out if you had a set of scales like this, right? Let's do this over here. By the way, if I put mystery box here, 2 here and 2 over here, how would I write that as an equation on a piece of paper?
x plus 2 equals 4,
right? So you're an ancient merchant. And you say, forget all of that. I know that this much stuff is equal to this much stuff. I'll just write it down with symbols, and I'll figure it out on paper, and then I'll know exactly how much that mystery thing is worth. So start off easy, but also let's be able to justify our answer, be able to show our work, show our steps. Yeah. Okay, so let's start with 2x plus 5. 13, right? Don't just guess. Certainly you can guess. You can figure it out. You can figure out that x is, what does it have to be? So it's 4. Look at it and figure out that it's 4. Let's show our work. Show our work. And it's just a couple steps.
6.
What? Is it 6?
No, no, no. I'm pretty sure it's 4.
Okay.
If I was wrong, it wasn't four, I wouldn't be surprised.
Huh?
No.
9? 9. 9. 9. No. Well, see, there's this mystery value x, right? And I know if I take what this equation is telling me, if I take that mystery value x and I double it, and now I doubled it, and now I added 5 to it, after I did all that, I got 13. And I multiplied it by 2, I don't know what it is, but I multiplied it by 2, I've added 5, and in the end, I wound up 13. Well, to get back to what x is, right, this is not exactly the rule that I would expect you to follow. I think you can use your common sense, but if you were to follow, reverse order of operations, and you would get right at what x is. If you look at x, and you see, well, what's happening to x? Well, I'll follow the order of operations. If you reverse that, you'll get x down, you know, down to what x is, would be down, having x by itself. All right, so if I started with x, and I'm going to first multiply, right? Well, that would be the last thing that I do the opposite of. The last thing I do is add 5. So the first thing I'll do is subtract that 5 away. Why? Because on this side, what all I'm really getting is 2x plus what?
0.
5 minus 5. 0. Okay. So I get 2x plus 0 equals, well, I got to subtract 5 on this side. And we get 8. Well, this is silly. You know, I don't have to write 0 every time. It's just 2x is what's on the left side. Well, 2 times some number is 8, so, well, half of 8 must be what that number is, right? Divide by 2 on both sides. Divide by 2. 2 divides 2, we've got 1 times x, that's what we've really done over there, equals 4. 1 times x is x, so x is 4. You gotta pay close attention. Here's a classic mistake. Something like this. Divide by 2, divide by 2. X plus 5 equals whatever 13 divided by 2 is. Anybody see a mistake there? Like, what's the problem?
Why well, it's technically right.
Is it technically right?
You don't have to follow the order of operations.
Okay, true. You don't have to follow the order of operations. But is what I've done here correct?
No.
Why not? Yeah, when I subtract 5, I should get 4. That's not going to happen here, is it?
No.
So if I wanted to divide by 2 in the first step, then what?
You have to divide by
2. Yeah, you got to divide the 5. Like, you can divide everything by 2. You're going to divide this by 2. I need to divide this by 2. Think about the scales over there, right? They're both balanced to start with. If I divide, say, let's say we divide this by 2, divide 13 by 2, the other side, the whole thing, needs to get divided by 2. Right? So if I divide this side by 2, I need to divide it, divide the whole thing right by 2. Alright? So divide 2x by 2, that's great, I get x, but here I get 5 halves. X plus 5 halves equals 13 halves. Subtract 5 halves from both sides. X equals
4.
Well, 4. 8 halves. 4.
You nailed it.
I'm just gonna throw one at you, see how you do. Okay, solve for x. Solve for x using algebra. Algebra would be the method by which we reconcile the unknown quantity.
Minus 7.
Okay, so what's the work that you're going to go through to figure out what x is? What's your work?
Minus 7.
No, not what is x. Like, what you do to figure out what x is. Subtract 4, great, that's what I'm looking for. Yeah.
And
divide by negative 3. Negative 3 divided by negative 3 is 1x. 21 divided by negative 3 is negative 7. We want a positive x, we don't want a negative x. So it's not enough to just divide by 3. You could do that, you just be left with a negative x out of that. 1, so let's do it all. Take a side break. We just all side break.
Okay.
Okay. Let's take a short break. Okay. So we have done some basic stuff. If we need to add or subtract both sides, I'm just confident you guys can do that. Divide the same thing on both sides, even if it's negative, sure, we can do that. So what do we do if we have 5 sevenths x equals 30? Yes. Okay, so if we use the same idea as over here, divide by the same thing on both sides, right? Divide, this is a very useful thing to keep at the front, not even the back, the front of your mind. If there's something multiplied by x, okay, and it's just a single x, like there's not x here and x somewhere else. If it's something times x, let's divide by that thing, okay? Even if, let me just give you a, like a vision of the future. Like, even if it's like 3 plus 9z minus y equals 4. Well, if I want to figure out what x is worth, I'm not going to get a number, but I am going to get x by itself, right? Well, I will divide by that thing. That is multiplied by x, yeah? Always. Now, if there's an x somewhere inside here, now we got another problem. We got to figure that out. But if there's an x there and it's multiplied by a number or a quantity or a fraction or anything, just divide by that thing. Divide by, just think about it. And of course, divide the same thing over here, 3 plus 9, right there. If you, whatever y and z are, you plug in 5 for y and 12 for z, whatever number you get here, you're going to get the exact same number here. They're going to divide each other, they're going to cancel each other out, they just cancel each other out, and just leave with x. And then whatever is over here, that's what x is worth, right? So let's get rid of all this. Come back to here, we'll divide by 5 sevenths on both sides. Okay, same idea, divide by whatever x is being multiplied by. We want to undo that multiplication, so we undo that multiplication with division. So this side's easy, right? Anything divided by itself is 1, so we're left with 1x. But then it would be much easier on the other side to do what when we multiply by the reciprocal of 5%. Reciprocal of 5, 7. 30 over 1 times 7 over 5 plus cancel. Times 7, 42. So x is equal to 42.
Couldn't you like also just take x times 7 and 30 times 7 and then 5x is equal to whatever 30 times 7 was?
Good point, yes. So we could start over. 5 sevenths x equals 30. What'd you say, multiply first?
Multiply by 7.
Multiply by 7. Okay, it cancels, right? Because we get 35 over 7, and that's just going to be 5. And then we'll multiply this by 7. And 5x equals 210. 7 times 3 times 10. And then what? Divide by 5. And of course, that'll still be 42. Right?
Yep.
Or. Almost exactly the same as this, except for instead of writing it as divide by 5 sevenths, I'll just multiply by 7 fifths, yeah? Just multiply by 7 fifths. Multiply by 7 fifths. All right. But still, the idea is the same. We are dividing by the thing that x is multiplied by.
It's okay, it's not like a band last time when we were taking the test.
We're going to do your test, but we're going to end up.
Okay, how about, this is for you. Go ahead and work this in your notes. Work out very nicely, but you can certainly figure out what x is. I want you to work it out in your notes, each of you individually. So we want to get x by itself. And 12, let's see. As we try to strip things away from x, as these equations become more and more complicated, let's try and take those easy, low-hanging fruit away from x. So if there's something added or subtracted, that's, you know, that's like the last thing that you're gonna do to x, right? You're gonna do all this stuff, and you're gonna add, or you're gonna subtract 12. So let's just get rid of that minus 12 part, right? Negative 12 plus 12 gives us plus 0. And we add 12 here, we get 35. Then we divide by 3/11. 3/11. Of course, anything divided by itself is 1, so we have 1x. And we'll save ourselves a little time. Instead of dividing by 3/11, we'll multiply by 11 over 3. 385 over 3. Really want to see this happening. I see in the calculator you're just doing this. You're kind of robbing yourself of understanding that will, I know, it's better to understand what we're doing here rather than to throw this in there. And even though, I mean, using the parentheses there, that's very important to do. If you didn't do that, then you could start getting answers that not everybody would get. And what else? Yeah, and then just to get to this decimal, losing understanding. Okay. So let's get in the habit of, if we're working with some fractions, let's work with some fractions. Okay, let's not be intimidated by that anymore. Right. Now we'll have mystery box on both sides. The goal here is to figure out what P is worth. What is 1P equal to? What's P worth? So we want to get a single P by itself on one side of the equation. So we might start with this 13. It says we can subtract 13. Of course, we can subtract 13 from negative 5. They're both just integers. We can combine those. They are like terms, right? 7P equals 9P minus 18. What are we going to do about P's on both sides? Should I divide by 7 right now?
No, subtract.
Subtract 9. Size. Negative 2p equals negative 18. Why is this still happening right now? Now what?
Divide by negative 2.
P equals positive 9.
Woo!
Okay.
That was great.
Variables on both sides, we need to bring them together on one side. You can't let them be on two different sides. That won't work at all, yeah?
How would it work if one of them?
That would be a trickier thing that we don't have to worry about quite yet, because that would be a quadratic equation. It takes a lot more to understand that. We will do that in, I don't know, a few weeks, maybe months.
Ooh, wow. That's a long time.